Brothers and sisters in Christ of Zion Lutheran Church, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to Him, the Almighty God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we know that no creature is hidden from your sight. Have mercy upon us, and may your ears and eyes always be toward your faithful children to hear their cries. This we pray in the name of Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The basis for today's sermon is centered around the last three verses of the letter to the Hebrews, verses 11 through 13. Many things tend to divide us in today's world, be it the food we eat, be it the sports team that we like, or the music that we listen to. And honestly, these are all trivial things, to be sure, but divisions and stark divisions can come up from such strong affiliations. Stronger divisions are present into today's world. All one has to do is ask someone their political affiliation. The answer that is given is usually a turning point in conversations. It is like what we heard a few weeks ago in the letter from St. James. It is like a spark that on a bed of dry leaves sets the whole course of nature ablaze. And from this major division, the political affiliation, many other divisions arise. Divisions such as same-sex marriage, abortion, taxes, and the like. And they further drive wedges between people, and they can even tear families into pieces. And many of these divisions are not without meaning. These divisions help us to identify people who think like us, who share a common view of life with us. There is one division, though, that pierces through all other. A division that separates right from wrong. A division that separates the sheep from the goats. A division that separates the 10 virgins in being either foolish or wise. A division that separates the wheat from the tares. A division that separates the righteous from the unrighteous. And this division comes from God. The reading from Hebrews shows us this. It reads, "No creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account." And what is there other than the word of God that bears us before him to reveal our true state of dust and ashes? The word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And this division, the word of God, is twofold. First, the word of God divides soul and spirit from joints and marrow. And how does it do this? By convicting the soul of its wretched state. St. Paul states in his letter to the Romans that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The psalmist states in chapter 51 that my sin is always before me. Against you, God, only you have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. And in Isaiah 43, God declares, I have not caused you to serve with grain offerings, nor wearied you with incense, but you have burdened me with your sins. You have wearied me with your iniquities. We hear these accusations, and we, like those who are gathered around Jesus in today's gospel reading, cry out, "Then, O Lord, who can be saved?" And of course, the answer to this question is no one. But only through God can salvation come. Not through man, not through any possessions that we have, not through any devotion that we show to any sports team or political figure. The Word of God, again, pierces deep. But this time, rather than conviction, for conviction has already happened by showing us our true state. Because even our good works are nothing but filthy rags before God. But this time, the Word of God brings salvation. The Word now brings restitution. The Word now brings us, makes us righteous before God. Later in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, he states that Christ was sent as an offering to regain the goodwill of God. This offering, Jesus Christ, demands that God overlook all of our sins, all sins that have been committed, and all sins that will be committed. And later in Isaiah 43, God declares to us his righteousness. He states, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake. And I will not remember your sins. And it is as Christ states, with man it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. This is the first device of action of the Word of God. It separates body and soul. It divides the old Adam from the new Adam. And the second division is one that is more corporeal, more physical, better recognized by us. And this division relates to the righteous and the unrighteous. And we read this plainly in Matthew 10. And to many of us, this strikes closer to our heart than most verses. Jesus Christ says, "I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother. And a man's enemy will be those of his own household. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me." And that is us, right? For we say, as St. Peter declared in today's gospel reading, "See, we have left everything and followed you." And that is true. But what is also true is the word of Christ that he speaks in response. Those who have left all to follow Christ will receive something else. And it's true. The Word of God in Jesus Christ does bring a sword. It will cut us off from family and friends, from those that we hold dear. But it also brings something else. It brings a new family to us, new brothers, new sisters, new lands, and importantly, a new home. And this new home is the church. And these brothers and sisters are you, dear saints. We are now all part of the family of God. All who proclaim that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, the same confession that St. Peter proclaimed so long ago, they are members of the family of God. All who have been baptized into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are all members of that family as well. All who have partaken in the most holy supper, the Lord's Supper, and proclaim it as it is, the true body and the true blood of Jesus Christ are members of this family. These gifts, baptism, the Holy Sacrament, the Lord's Supper, the church, Christ has given to us, and he has given it to us freely. For there's nothing that we need to do to gain these gifts from him. And through his ascension, he has given us these gifts when he ascended to the right hand of God. From there, he sends us his Holy Spirit through baptism. And from there, he gives us his very own body and blood that he may dwell within us. And from there, he speaks the words of absolution, that our sins are forgiven by his blood. In his ascension, he gives us these gifts, as St. Paul tells us in Ephesians 4, that he gave gifts to man. But he cannot ascend until he has descended into hell to claim victory over Satan. And he cannot descend into hell until he has been crucified on the cross, where his body was broken and his blood was shed for us in our place for our sins, by taking our sins unto himself, becoming sin in our place. Thanks be to God that Jesus Christ, the Word that became flesh, was pierced on our behalf, that we may live in peace and unity with our Heavenly Father, both now and to life everlasting. Amen. Now may the Father of all hope strengthen our faith in his only beloved Son, Jesus Christ, by the unity of the Holy Spirit. Amen.